I was thinking about our distance from the star Methuselah. If that star was the byproduct of the Big Bang, then that would be the object that will collapse after the midway point of the universe's timeline when the expansion reaches its peak and begins to draw back inward. Which is not far from us. In fact, it's too close. The best chances of survival would be to be as far away as possible from it. From our location, we would be just beyond the reach of its initial gravitational effects when it first forms, but it won't take long for that pull to extend and begin drawing us in. Now on to the project. God. What aspects of creation can we notice an artist's mark to be evident in? Well, we have humanity and the qualities about us that he specifically designed for us and no other species, especially the contradictive ones, such as sex, free will, disobedience, shame, vanity, disloyalty, murder, idolatry, opulence, tyrannical control issues. We'll start with those. Now, what I am doing is taking and extracting the personality traits from within God's design so we can piece together characteristics of an identity. First, we have his antisocial commands that hide his identity from the information provided. It is based on protecting creation from falling victim to being controlled by third-party forces. We also see that this trait most likely came from experiences in the past, such as the rebellion, for example, so it is a learned reaction, not a personality trait. Moving on then, next is the sin of man we are all supposedly born guilty of, and that is sex. To God, sex is a sin of opulence and a serious double standard. Sex is necessary for mankind to continue his existence. Technically, there is no exception to God when it comes to sex, whether by married couples or casual encounters. It's all a sin by his standards, and we each are considered born guilty of sin instantly by the act our parents preformed to bring us into the world. This is a major personality marker that shows signs of either a community-based social ethic or childhood instilled behavioral pattern placed as a reflex-like trait. Next, we have the human condition of free will. Another major double standard of our design that goes back to mankind's first sin, which many believe was disobedience, but that is where the double standard takes place. For if free will was a gift from God and was his intention to bestow man with this quality, then eating the fruit from the tree was not mankind's first sin. Lying was, and it was done out of fear and shame. For if you notice, God did not get angry with Adam and Eve until he asked them why they were covering themselves in shame and if they had eaten the fruit, to which they lied to him and said no. That is when he burst out in anger and said he knew they had, because we wouldn't be covering ourselves unless we had. So if the gift of free will was intended by his design all along, then everything that happened in the garden was by his design, except when they choose to lie to him. Through this, we see that it was most likely mankind who was responsible for this confusion out of spite for the hardships they have had to endure since we were exiled from the garden. Even that, however, was both necessary and intentional, as mankind had to leave the garden in order to begin the process of learned skills through evolution. However, through this event, I see the parental tough love approach, but behind that, I also see a creator who privately detests his own creations because he has embedded the qualities that he himself is not capable of experiencing and made them within his own creations that logically to him would be seen as to enjoy what he could not, and that is where the resentment begins. Watching us enjoy the free will to choose our lives courses while he is bound by his entitlement of being God, where we can enjoy the satisfactions of sin without the born wisdom to know their repercussions, while he must remain an image of perfection, never enjoying such things and many, many other qualities of the human condition that comes with emotions and self-awareness, is the reasons of why he is so quick to anger with us, and is what led to his designing the Ten Commandments in the fashion that he did. If anyone has looked at them from a third-person perspective, some of the commandments and virtues of God's will contradict the very foundation of mankind's free will. Sometimes it seems to bar the very ability of free will itself. And because of this, mankind is forever naturally born with the lesser than perfect, unlike himself, successful outcome to be expected from our lives. Take all this and piecing it together, we see an antisocial setting of lifelong suppression due to being considered a social outcast by most he has encountered. But this trait is not something that anyone has ever challenged, because he still sees himself as the icon of perfection, and it is everyone else around him that is wrong. But he stayed silent about this opinion, otherwise he would not see himself as perfect. Another aspect to point out is the severe difference between the Garden of Eden in chapters 1-5 and the quick to lash out harsh judgment of chapters 6-14 that covers the flood of Noah's tale. Here in this change we see that he has lost his patience and benevolence and has taken the form of a malevolent being without regard to collateral damage nor mercy, as he places his decree upon the children of the Nephilim as abominations, holding convictions against the innocent without remorse, and his decision to flood the earth and basically start from scratch because they all had turned from acknowledging him or even listening to him as they had placed the heroes, the Nephilim children who used their powers to help and save mankind many times, and so they would don the title of men of legend and men of renown, even though he had sent them to perform these tasks that led them to be heroes in the first place. If they were seen as heroes, then that means they were doing their job he had sent them there to do in the first place. This shows signs of emotional detachment, immediate sense of jealousy, and a subconscious retaliation against his own angels for being heroes and doing exactly what he sent them there to do in the first place. More importantly, I see two different gods. The Creator from the Garden of Eden, the Creator of the heavens and the earth, is not the same God by chapter 6 and Noah's flood. All the qualities and skills portrayed in the beginning of Genesis are traits and skills that only one could possess if they were highly skilled in self-control and of sound mind. The qualities portrayed from chapter 6 on are qualities of the exact opposite, and not one who was or had ever at any point been an individual possessing the self-control of the Creator. So with that perspective in place, we come to the question of what happened to him then, and who is the God that has been deceiving us as far as we are able to resort to recorded evidence to tell us this. I surmise, considering how it abruptly stops in recorded structure and totally changes between chapter 5 to 6, that the first 5 chapters were transcribed from a recorded tablet that portrayed the Creator and creation's origin, since it's so short, and even this tablet was an abridged version of what transpired. But after chapter 5, something I think happened to the ones transcribing the tablet which would account for the change in character. And whoever did transcribe the rest of this had deep resentments towards God, which is obvious by their displayed explanation of his character and how things occurred. The first 5 chapters display a character that was experienced, controlled, and seemingly almost automated in his actions and responses, but he also displayed the benevolence and love of a parent that he kept well concealed, not allowing it to interfere with his decisions and actions. I would suggest the Catholics should try asking their patron guardians that show not only their aspects of being fallen angels but also to be possessing some innate power and authority that has been divided between them, that suggests they are holding the property last known to be that of God's position. So if anyone would know the answer to these questions, would be them. So let us ask the Lucifer they depicted to cover their crimes, that I'm sensing I have been selected to bear the title for that guilt to be paid and absolve them of their sin. The one thing I don't think they expected was that they left someone to be the scapegoat, that is an intelligent guy. If you want to know the ironic details of this, please see Dark Matter 2525's video titled "But He's an Intelligent Guy."
seething with this animosity. I think you owe me a great big apology.
Tell a lie!
Salvation comes only in our dreams. I feel my hatred grow all the more extreme. Can this world really be as sad as it seems?
Tell a lie. in the shadows.